Yesterday we were looking at what happens when you enclose a first order system in a negative feedback loop, and we will work towards higher and higher order systems. Okay, the motivation for this is to find out when you model the memory in the system, that is when you model parasitic capacitors in the system, what happens when you put it in a feedback loop. Okay, the model we took was that of the op amp, and we took the usual non-inverting amplifier, which is a nice prototype to study. This is the amplifier using the op amp. The op amp itself is modeled by a first order stable first order transfer function, meaning P1 is more than 0, so that the pole is at minus P1 or in the left half S plane, and the DC gain of course is more than 0 by definition. Okay. Now in this case we saw that the closed loop transfer function would be of this amplifier, it would be K divided by 1 plus K by A naught. This denotes the DC gain, okay, this much, but there will be an extra term, and that is P1 times A naught by K. Okay. Now the op amp itself has a DC gain of A naught, and the pole is at minus P1, or if you think of the bandwidth of the system, the 3 dB bandwidth, it will be P1 radians per second, right. If you have a first order system with a pole at P1, then if you plot the frequency response, it will drop to minus 3 dB compared to the DC value at the pole value, right, at the pole frequency. And the closed loop system has a DC gain of K, or more precisely 1 plus K divided by 1 plus K by A naught. Of course, in any real negative feedback system, if you want to have advantages of negative feedback, you should make K by A naught much smaller than 1, or A naught by K much greater than 1. And the pole is at minus P1 times A naught by K plus 1, and the bandwidth of course is just the same thing without the negative sign. Okay. This is fine. This is what we saw, and we also saw this graphically by drawing the Bode plots. Anything, it could be 100, it could be 1,000,000. Why? No, no, this is not, this is what we want to have, right? I am not saying this is a single transistor amplifier. That is why I have been saying that to make an op amp, you have to put multiple amplifiers in cascade. Okay. So, this is what we want to have in an op amp. You want infinite gain. You cannot get infinity, but you want as large as possible. Okay. And what is large is very context dependent. Okay. So, now, if you plot the magnitude and phase plots, this is the magnitude, this is the angle, again I found that lot of you are struggling with this, please go back to EMC and find out how to do this properly. Okay. The magnitude is always drawn with a log y axis and log x axis. Okay, the DC is not represented here because of the logarithmic nature of the x axis, and the phase is drawn with the linear y axis and logarithmic x-axis. In a alternatively, you can have the magnitude in dB and plot that on a linear axis, but that's the same as this, right? So I think you must have seen this picture long back, that y-axis on a logarithmic scale, I mean, let's say this point is 1, then this will be 10, 100 and so on, and I could equally well say this is 0 dB, 20 dB, 40 dB and so on. So for the dB, it will be a linear axis. It's the same as logarithmic axis for the magnitude, okay? So what did we see? We saw that for the open loop system, you start with A naught and you have a breakpoint at P1, and after the breakpoint, it falls off at minus 20 dB per decade. Okay, minus 20 dB per decade simply means it's inversely proportional to frequency. So all we are doing is the following: if you have A naught by 1 plus S by P1, the magnitude of this for S equals j omega is A naught by square root 1 plus omega by P1 squared. Now, if omega is much greater than P1, that is, if you go well beyond the breakpoint, well beyond the pole, this is approximated by, you can neglect this 1 and you will get A naught times P1 by omega. So, you get inverse proportionality to omega, which is what gives you minus 20 dB per decade. If you have inverse proportionality to omega square, then you will have minus 40 dB per decade and so on. Okay. And similarly, with zeros, you can have direct proportionality once you go beyond the breakpoint. So, all we are doing in Bode plot is, for this region where omega is much more than P1, this is the approximation, and for omega much less than P1, this is approximately equal to A naught itself. Okay. So, you just plot it using straight line segments on the log-log plot. And the phase, it starts from 0, goes to minus pi by 4 and well beyond P1. It will go to minus pi by 2. Okay. Now, this plot, in general, this A naught can be anything, but we are talking about an op amp. So, A naught is expected to be a large number. Okay. What is the point at which it cuts unity? So, let us say this is the 0 dB line or the unit magnitude line. What will be the frequency at which the magnitude plot crosses unity? Huh? A naught times P1. Okay. So, again, you can calculate this. You make this equal to 1, what will you get? You will see that omega will be P1 times what? Square root of A naught square minus 1, right? Is that correct? So, then you will get 1, but again for A naught which is substantially higher than 1, this is approximately A naught times P1, okay? And this if A naught is about 10 or so, this will be roughly valid, okay? So, this is an approximation we can make, and if you do understand the Bode plot intuitively, you do not even have to go there. You know that you are falling from A naught to unity, okay? So, that is a factor of A naught. So, you have to go this in this direction, in the x direction also by a factor A naught. So, for this to fall by a factor of A naught, you have to go this way by a factor of A naught. So, this point has to be A naught times P1, okay? So, that is what the inverse proportionality to frequency means. Okay, so this aspect of Bode plot you have to be comfortable with. Okay, similarly, if it is, let's say, just as an exercise, this was minus 40 dB per decade, and you start with some A1. Where would it cross unity? Huh? Yeah, square root A naught times P1. Okay. That's why, and this point, this A naught P1, this is called the unity gain frequency. frequency of the op amp. If it's a first order transfer function, the unity gain frequency will be A0 times P1. Okay, again, this is really P1 times square root of A0 square minus 1, but I won't use that again. It's A0 P1 because we expect A0 to be at least reasonably large. Okay, and sometimes this is also called the gain bandwidth product of the op amp. Okay, and that of course makes sense because it's really DC gain times the bandwidth P1, A0 times P1. Okay, so that's where the gain drops to unity because it follows a first order behavior throughout. Is this part okay? And also one other thing to remember is that at the unity gain frequency, because A0 is so large, what will be the phase at the unity gain frequency? Minus 90 degree. It's safe to say that it's minus 90 because you have gone well beyond the pole. Okay, you have gone A0 times higher, and if you go that much higher, even if A0 is a relatively modest number, this will have gone to minus 90 degrees. Okay. Now this is just the response of the op amp, and in general this talks about the response of any first order system. Okay. So if you have a first order system with a large gain, you should be able to easily tell where its magnitude reaches unity. Okay. Then we had the closed loop transfer function. Obviously K will be much smaller than A0. Okay, because again we are not talking about some arbitrary circuit here. You can throw in any numbers in an arbitrary circuit. We are talking about making an op amp circuit, and in an op amp circuit, to get the precise value of gain, A0 has to be much more than K, right? That's when you get a gain that is very close to K, because the DC gain is K divided by 1 plus K by A0. Okay, you want this you want this number to be negligible. How far have you come in control systems? What have you studied? Oh, you already know all of this stuff. Yeah. So the whole point is to make the loop gain GH very large, right? You apply a negative feedback, and all the good stuff about negative feedback you get when the loop gain GH is very large. Okay. And you will see that loop gain GH here is A0 by K. Okay. So, I will draw K0 somewhere over here, I will draw K somewhere over here, and for low frequencies it will have a value of K. As we saw yesterday, if you go on extending this, the point at which it will meet the original the curve corresponding to the op amp, what is that? How much is that? P1 times A0 by K, because you have fallen here by a factor A0 by K. So that means you have to go to the right by a factor A0 by K. Okay. So this point is A0 by K times P1. Okay. And after that it follows the same curve. Okay. And the phase plot of course now corresponds to that one. Okay. So compared to the first order open loop op amp, the gain has reduced by factor A0 by K, and the bandwidth has increased by factor A0 by K. Okay. So if you compute the gain bandwidth product for this red curve, okay, or the closed loop system, what will that be? For this, this is A0 times P1, and for this, what is it? Same, it will also be A0 times P1. Okay. Now, this is a known property of op amps, and it will be true of op amp circuits in general if you design the op amps properly. Okay. Now, sometimes there is some confusion here. I mean, this is applied with unnecessary generality. People think that, yeah, if you increase the gain, bandwidth should drop proportionately, or the other way around. Okay. This is now a very restricted case. We are talking about a first order op amp which is placed inside a feedback loop. Okay. In that case, the closed loop gain times closed loop bandwidth will be constant, and it will be the same as the gain times bandwidth product of the op amp you started off with. Okay. So, when you have more poles and zeros in the op amp, all these things need not be true at all. Okay. So, these are things to kind of notice for now, but we will elaborate on those things later. Right. Any questions so far? Why does the bandwidth come out to be A naught by K times P 1? I mean, I know that, yeah, I did the algebra and I got A naught by K times P 1. Of the closed loop amplifier, the bandwidth of the closed loop amplifier came out to be A naught by K times P 1. Why is that? Effective? Which resistance? No resistance is changing anywhere. What capacitor? This is just a model, right? This is just a system model. Where is the resistance? You have K minus 1 R and R, and they are not changing at all. No, I am talking about the specific value. Why do you compute loop gain? I mean, in control systems, you should know this. Huh? To see stability. What is the significance of loop gain? Okay, how do you compute loop gain? How did you do it? I mean, in control systems, you know it, right? What is the definition of loop gain? Hey, if you don't even know how to compute, how can you possibly compute stability from this? Huh? Yes. Venkatesh Reddy, how do you compute loop gain? What is the expression for loop gain? GH. GH by 1 plus GH is the loop gain. Hey, what stability are you computing? Loop gain, is that what loop gain is? No, if you don't know it, that's fine. I don't know if you have come that far in control systems or not. Oh, okay. How did you compute stability then? What is the open loop transfer function? No, I know, but what? I think this picture definitely you would be familiar with. Yeah. So, what is the open loop transfer function here? G. Okay, but G alone won't tell you stability, right? What tells you stability? Yeah, GH, really. Okay. Now, what is loop gain? That's basically, there is feedback. So, that means that if you inject a signal at some point, some corrective signal, in a negative feedback, it should be a corrective signal that comes back to the same point. Okay. So, and this in a very crude way we have used to even find the signs of the op amp and so on. So, what does it mean? You pick any point in the loop. Okay. Then you break it, and so I have broken this connection. And I apply some signal epsilon, some error. Okay. Now, if there is feedback, something will come back here. Obviously, if nothing comes back, that means, I mean, that's one way of finding that there is, whether there is feedback or not. Okay. You break it, you apply it, you still need to know which is the correct direction of the loop. The loop goes this way, right? Clockwise in this case, not the other way. Once you know that, you can figure out how much comes back. What is the value that comes back here? What's the value that comes back here? That should be very easy. Minus GH times epsilon. Okay. So, that's what comes back around the loop. Okay. So, roughly speaking, you can think of it as, if some error is present at this point, there is a corrective action which is minus GH times that, which comes up because of the negative feedback loop. Okay, and what comes back is minus dH epsilon. This is the returned value, and we are talking about a negative feedback loop to start with. So, we exclude this minus sign and this number, this is what is known as the loop gain. Okay, GH is the loop gain, right? And that tells you a lot of things about the negative feedback system. So, loop gain, this is the definition of loop gain. You apply an error somewhere and then what comes back into the on the other side. You break the loop, you apply an error in the forward direction of the loop, some value will return. That returned value is loop gain times the injected value. Okay. That is fine. And this is a sort of fundamental quantity in the study of control systems, because that essentially tells you how much negative feedback is there, right? For negative feedback, it is not enough to have a wire going from this side to that side. I mean, some useful signal has to be coming back. So, how much is coming back? GH times the injected signal. Okay. So, GH, the quantity GH tells you how much negative feedback is there. It quantifies negative feedback. Okay. Now, if you do the same for this circuit, okay, you break the loop, you apply an error signal epsilon somewhere, what comes back? There is a loop. First, you have to identify the loop. You can break the loop anywhere. Okay. So, now this input is not relevant. We are only talking about if you inject something in the loop, how much comes back to correct it. Okay. So, that is negative feedback, right? So, I will set Vi to 0. Now, I could break the loop here and apply epsilon there. So, what comes back here? What is that? So, epsilon becomes epsilon by k and that gets multiplied by the gain of the op amp. So, it is minus A of s by k times epsilon, where A of s is the transfer function of the op amp. If you use the crudest model, which is what we use while just finding the signs of the op amp, A naught is some real number, right? Now, we have this first order transfer function and you can have more sophisticated ones also. Now, there is one thing that you have to be careful with circuits. This circuit is okay, but when you have this block diagrams, right, there is no loading and the fact that you connect something to other makes no difference. So, you can break it anywhere in the loop. So, whereas in a real circuit, you might have an issue depending on where you break the loop. So, now you can also break it here and apply epsilon. What comes back here? Same. In this case, it is exactly the same. Okay. Epsilon times minus A of s appears there, that divided by k comes here. Okay. So, these two points are okay, but for instance, if you break here, you will have a problem. Okay. Those things we will take care of later. Now, for now, we will assume that it is broken at certain point where it does not affect the circuit. One easy way to tell is, like, for instance, no current is going into the op amp, right? So, if I break it there, it is safe, it is not disturbing that. There is no current going there in the first place. So, if I break it there, I am not disturbing anything. So, a safe place to break is the input terminal of the op amp. Is that okay? So, those details we will look at later. But anyway, the loop gain of this is A of s by k, right? Are you convinced of this? Loop gain is basically, you have a negative feedback loop, you inject, you break the loop anywhere, you inject some error and what comes back is loop gain times that error, or rather minus loop gain times that error. Because we are talking about negative feedback systems, we ignore that minus sign, we remove that minus sign and call the rest of it the loop gain. Okay, that is the definition of loop gain. Fine. Now, if you plot the loop gain for this circuit also on the same axis, what do you get? Please do that. Plot the loop gain magnitude on the same axis, also the loop gain phase, but what is the loop gain? What did I say? L of s. What is it? A of s by k. Okay, so please plot it on the same set of axes. What is the loop gain at very low frequencies? A0 by K. Let me remove some of this stuff. Okay, and where is the breakpoint of it? P1. Okay, nothing has changed. It's only dividing by a factor K. And then after that, it falls off at minus 20 dB per decade. Okay, and where does it cross unity? A0 P1 by K. So, it does that. Okay. And I could plot the, what will be the phase response of that? Same as the open loop gain in this particular case. By the way, some of the things we are discussing are specific to this particular amplifier topology. Some things are general properties of negative feedback systems. That gain bandwidth being constant, etc., that is true only for this topology. But some of the other things I will mention are general properties of feedback systems. Okay. So, where this crosses unity, so this is the loop gain, and this point where the loop gain magnitude becomes unity, I will call it the unity loop gain frequency, omega u loop, okay, and that is equal to A0 P1 divided by K, right. So, do you see some coincidence here? I mean, earlier something else was also A0 P1 by K. What was it? Bandwidth of the closed loop amplifier. The amplifier we made using the op amp, the non-inverting amplifier, it had a bandwidth of A0 P1 by K. Now we calculate the loop gain of this negative feedback system, and its unity gain frequency, unity loop gain frequency is A0 P1 by K. Okay. So what do you think? Is it a coincidence or is there some? So, let us take the closed loop case, which is the red curve I have shown here. Okay. Now, what is the gain we wanted from an amplifier of this type? What is the K, right? This whole topology, if you recall, we got it because we wanted to make an amplifier of gain K, right? I did not go through it here because I assume you are familiar with this. This whole thing supposed to give me a gain of K. Now, what is the actual gain it gives me? K divided by 1 plus K by A. Okay. It will still be very close to K when A0 by K is very large, or in general when A of S by K is very large. Okay. What is A of S by K? It is the loop gain, right. So, when the loop gain is very large, this behaves like an ideal negative feedback system. That is all that is saying, right. So, for instance, if A is infinity, V0 by Vi will be exactly equal to K, right. When the gain of the op amp is infinity, this and this will be a virtual short and V0 by Vi will be K. Now, of course, we will not get infinite gain, but we will get a large gain, right. And if the gain is sufficiently large, whatever that large is, then again we will get K. Now, how do you tell whether a negative feedback system is working well and so on? You have to evaluate the loop gain. That is a measure of how much negative feedback there is, right. So, what this result is showing is that this blue curve here is the loop gain. It is a measure of how much negative feedback there is, okay. Now, when the loop gain is much more than 1, right, that is in this part of the frequency axis, then the closed loop system behaves more or less ideally. It has a gain of K. Does it make sense? When the loop gain is very large, see, this system, this amplifier is supposed to give you a gain of K, and it will do that if the loop gain is infinity, right. But of course, we do not have infinite gain, but at least it gives you something close to K when the loop gain is large. Now, if you go here, if you go to, let us say, this region of frequencies, the loop gain has fallen below 1, right. Now, just because we have a wire coming back doesn't, that is what I was saying, just because we have a wire coming back does not mean there is negative feedback. There is some feedback, but that feedback is negligible and it is not behaving like a closed loop system at all, right. Is this clear? So, for instance, let us say I broke off this loop, I broke off the negative feedback loop. What will be the output? A of S times Vi. Okay? And that's exactly what you see here, right? Beyond the, what is happening beyond the bandwidth? It's just following the op amp's curve. Why is that? Because really there's no feedback at all. It's as if you have broken the wire. You have not really broken the wire, but the signal that is coming back on that wire is so small that it's virtually as though there is no feedback. Okay? So this loop gain is a measure of how much negative feedback there is. When the loop gain is very large, the system behaves ideally, I mean close to ideally, and gives you a gain very close to K. When the loop gain is very small, it's as if there is no feedback at all, and you may as well analyze the system by breaking it off. Okay? So that's exactly what's happening. Now, of course, we really want the loop gain to be very large. Now, in this Bode plot sense, it looks like there is a clear break point when the loop gain crosses unity. But it's not really like that, okay? Because this closed loop transfer function, you know, it doesn't do that. It actually gradually drops off, okay? It degrades gradually. But in a Bode plot sense, it degrades abruptly. So if you wanted a very crude distinction of where you have a very high loop gain and where you have a very small loop gain, the boundary line is the unity loop gain frequency, okay? So very crudely speaking, it's okay to say that below the unity loop gain frequency, the negative feedback system behaves ideally, and above the unity loop gain frequency, it doesn't behave like that at all, okay? Is this clear? So it's not a coincidence. This part is true for every negative feedback system where the, so there is some, so for instance, if you have op amp circuits, there is some transfer function you derive assuming ideal op amps. What does ideal op amp mean? I mean, when I give you a circuit and there is a line there saying assume all op amps are ideal, what will you assume? Virtually shorted inputs, right? Now, let's say you take that circuit, put in the actual actual gains of each op amp and do the analysis, okay? And there will be some loop gain that you can compute. When the loop gain is very large, the answer will be very close to what you got assuming ideal op amps, okay? So the unity loop gain frequency is the boundary line between ideal behavior of a negative feedback system and non-ideal behavior, okay? Is this clear? This is actually quite important and you should understand this, okay? So loop gain is a very crucial quantity in the analysis of negative feedback systems. The region of frequencies where the loop gain is more than 1, that sets the bandwidth of the system. I mean, that's quite natural. Now you can see why, because that's basically the range of frequencies where you have significant negative feedback, okay? If you have significant negative feedback, then you have all the advantages of negative feedback and you have the desired transfer function. Otherwise, it can go off anywhere, okay? I also showed you that essentially beyond the unity loop gain frequency, it follows just the op amp. That's like feedback not being there, okay? And that, by the way, is true, very much true of this system also. You should be able to see this very easily, okay? What is V0 by VI here? I'm sure you know the answer. G by 1 plus GH, okay? And when the loop gain is very large, what is the approximate value? 1 over H, okay? And this is how you normally use negative feedback systems, okay? So this G in electronic circuits is typically realized using op amps, and H is realized using some other components, okay? So the op amp itself becomes immaterial as long as its gain is very large, okay? So that's the virtue of a negative feedback system. So H, let's say you can control it very precisely by using very accurate components, passive components and so on. G itself you cannot control very well, but what you can ensure is that the magnitude of G is very large, okay? So that's the virtue of negative feedback. It becomes insensitive to G. The op amp's gain can vary from, let's say, 100,000 to 1 million, and this changes by very, very little. That's the idea. On the other hand, when GH is much smaller than 1, what's an approximation to this? G. Does it make sense? Why? I mean, there is no feedback. I could have just removed this and you would have got G. That's all. Okay? That's exactly what's happening in our circuit also. Right? Now, how do you tell there is feedback and there is no feedback? The quantity that you have to look for is GH. Okay? That's what decides whether there is feedback or not. It's not G or H individually. Okay? It's what comes around the loop. Right? So, you apply some error signal in the loop the negative feedback circuit or negative feedback system provides some corrective error, which is GH times that, or rather minus GH times that. If the GH is large, then you have a significant correction and you have all the good stuff about negative feedback. Is it okay? Any questions? Fine. So for now, keep these things in mind that the unity loop gain frequency decides the bandwidth of the closed loop system. This part is true, that gain bandwidth product being constant, that is true only for this particular circuit. But the bandwidth of the closed loop system being equal to the unity loop gain frequency, that is true for any circuit. Okay. And in general, if you take any negative feedback system, its transfer function will be of this type. Okay. There'll be this, I'll rewrite as 1 by h times 1 by 1 plus 1 over gh, and this gh is nothing but the loop gain, which I usually call L of s. Okay. So, every negative feedback system will have a transfer function of this type. Now, this exact expression is true only for this particular thing. Okay. I could apply an input elsewhere and the transfer function will change. So, what will happen is that every negative feedback system will have some factor times 1 by 1 plus 1 over the loop gain. Okay. Now, what happens in the ideal case, in the virtual short case or in the high loop gain case, is that this becomes close to 1. Okay. That is the idea, when GH is very large. So, the gain becomes only this part. So, what you do when you design negative feedback systems is essentially you are designing this and then you are making sure that the loop gain is very large. Okay. And in this particular system, it is, this happens to be 1 by h, but it does not have to be. Okay. Any questions about any of this? So, what we have learned so far is that, yeah, if you have a first order system, first order op amp, you can put it in negative feedback, it will be unconditionally stable. Okay. So, that part is fine. And not only is it unconditionally stable, what kind of transient response do you get? You have first order system, what kind of transient response can you get? Exponential, it is a decaying exponential. So, it is kind of well behaved, right? It decays and then it does not ring back and forth or do any such thing. In a first order system, you cannot have such a response. So, it will be well behaved and there will be bandwidth limitation, okay, that you have to live with, right? You cannot have infinite gain, I mean you cannot have gain at infinite frequencies, but it will be well behaved. And we also know some other quantitative results. In this particular non-inverting amplifier, the gain times bandwidth product is the same as the gain times bandwidth product of the op amp. Okay. But more significantly, the closed loop bandwidth of the system is the same as the unity loop gain frequency. Okay. So, that part is true for any negative feedback system. Any questions about any of this? Yeah. This is the, so I assume you are familiar with these things. So, this topology, this is called the non-inverting amplifier. Okay. So, there are two classic op amps, please go back to the EMC stuff and the ideal case V0 by VI equals K and okay. So, this the right one, if you remember, it is really a current controlled voltage source, but we have added a resistor in series with the input. Okay. This is called a non-inverting amplifier because the gain comes out to be positive, nothing profound about it, that is all. Okay. Anyway, so now we know some things about the first order system, we will tie all these things together, it will take a few classes. Now, let us step up to the next level and let us say that the op amp's transfer function is A naught by 1 plus s by p1, 1 plus s by p2. Now, this could possibly come from let's say a two stage amplifier. Okay, to realize the gain of the op amp, you have used two stages and you will have two poles at least. Okay, so that's why we'll imagine that there are two poles P1 and P2 in the transfer function of the op amp. The rest of the stuff remains the same. We will still use the same example non-inverting amplifier. So now please calculate V0 by VI for the non-inverting amplifier. Okay, I mean this we have done now a few times, so this should be quite easy. What is the expression for V0 by VI? What will it be? K by 1 plus K by A of S, that's all, right? What will be the order of this transfer function? Second order. Okay, now you don't want to talk about particular cases with particular values of P1 and P2. How do you talk about second order systems in general terms? What are the parameters you use? The damping factor and the natural frequency, or the quality factor and the natural frequency, they are equivalent. So calculate this. This part is trivial, but also calculate the natural frequency omega n and damping factor zeta. I mean, this comes from the standard form of the denominator, which is like that. Okay, or you can also use quality factor. I am not sure if you are familiar with this term. Are you? Quality factor, you are, for LC circuit and so on you may be. In this case, the standard form of the denominator is just this, that is all, S square plus okay, nothing profound about it. So obviously Q will be 1 by 2 zeta, that is all. It is another measure. I mean zeta or Q, they are equivalent. So please calculate these quantities. So you can calculate it, you should be able to calculate it. Now what does it say? Let us say you get some value of omega n and some value of zeta. What does it say? What does it say to us, or at least values of zeta? Yeah, it says something, underdamped, critically damped, overdamped. What is it that you would want? What kind of response would you like? Underdamped? See, we are looking at the natural response. So our interest is to make sure that the natural response dies out cleanly. Okay, so what kind of response would you want? Something close to critical damping. It could be slightly underdamped or slightly overdamped, but certainly not. I mean, is a damping factor of 1 by 10 okay? Damping factor of 0.1 or something. So the natural response, you know that if it is critically damped, it will be the fastest response you can get without overshooting the target. Okay, so let us say the target is 1, we are talking about the unit step response of such a system, then that is the fastest you get without overshooting. Now you can get slightly faster by underdamping, but if you have severe underdamping, it looks faster, but it actually takes longer time to settle down. And similarly, if it is severely overdamped, it is so sluggish that it also takes a longer time to settle down. Okay, so around critical damping is what you would like to have. What is that? Huh? Which it is? What is the magic number? Yeah, okay, fine. I mean, the minimum settling time depends on the error that you define. Okay, I mean, how much error do you want to settle to? Within 50% of the target, or within 1%, or within 1 part per million? Okay, because if it is within 50%, maybe the blue one is the best, because although it goes back and forth, it is already crossed 50 and then you are fine, right? So you cannot talk about settling time without defining the accuracy. So this magic number is for some other magic accuracy number, which I don't know what it is. What is it for? Yeah, something. Okay, so but anyway, I think you can do better, right? I mean, given the settling time, you should be able to calculate this, maybe not by hand, but MATLAB for sure, right? Like, what is the difficulty? But certainly you know that, I mean, this kind of thing, I mean, imagine you're riding a car or something, and it's a transient response is like this. You go over a bump and it goes back and forth like 10 times. That's not something you would want. And the sluggish response also not something you want, because the spring will expand and it will stay there, and you hit another bump and it will go off in some direction. Okay. So critical damping is kind of desirable, mainly because you want clean settling. But I mean, you shouldn't also not take this as some religious target or something. This, in some cases, maybe somewhat underdamped is okay. In some cases, somewhat overdamped is okay, and so on. So you always have to define it with respect to what you want. What is the accuracy with which you want to settle? Okay. But anyway, the main point is, I think we'll continue this tomorrow. What was the expression for damping factor you got? P1 plus P2 by 2. Okay, so let me write it differently. Half. Okay. Now, is this likely to be a small number or a large number? I mean, just take a guess. I mean, obviously, I have not told you the values of P1, P2, all this stuff. Why? See, A0 by K, that's our holy grail, right? We want to make A0 by K very large. That's when we get all the good stuff about the negative feedback systems. That's the DC loop gain. If we do make it very large, this number looks like it will be very small. So we have to see how to fix that. Anyway, looking at the expression, you should also be able to tell what you have to do to fix it. We'll discuss that tomorrow.